Above all powers, above all keys, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world. Above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth.
Crucify, lay me behind a stone, you live.
Use him as a holy prophet today. In the name of Jesus, use him, O God. Let your will alone be done. Let your plans and purposes be established so that by the long run we shall give testimony to glorify your name. Father God, equip us by your knowledge. Lord, there's a lot of lapses in town now. The word says the lack of knowledge my people perish. But we want to live here with knowledge and fire up so that we can destroy ignorance in the minds of people. We declare this program blessed.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much, Pastor Coffey. Two rounds, a four semester, 2 year program. And the lectures are once a week, which always in the evenings from 6:30 to 8 p.m. As a prelude to the graduation ceremony of Berea Academy, the public lecture is organized for the public to be educated theologically. So this year's lecture is the third in series. As such, there are other Bible schools who are invited to fraternize with us in this public lecture. We have in attendance, we have All Nations University College. If you hear from All Nations, just give us a wave. Then Trinity Theological Seminary. Then we invited also Pentecost University and Ghana Christian College. We invited Victory International Bible Training College. If they hear, let's see my hand. Then Good News Theological Seminary. We believe that in due course most of the students from these theological seminaries will join us soon. But we welcome you all specially to this lecture. But we also invited some people specially that we want to acknowledge. We acknowledge those who are here, and as the others join us, we acknowledge them as the program progresses. Hallelujah. I say hallelujah.
Amen.
It is a public lecture, but it's a church affair. So if I say hallelujah, please be comfortable to respond. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. We have in the house today Reverend Dr. Samuel Ohiniba Donyo. He is a theologian. He is an naturopathic physician. He is the International Vice President of International Theological Seminary, and he is a clinical consultant as well. We have in the house Reverend Dr. Samuel Ohiniba Donyo. Can we please give him a hand of applause? With him is the Registrar of International Theological Seminary, who is also a counselor and the resident pastor of Living Fountain International Ministry in the person of Reverend Hannah Bikowski. We also have in the house a renowned marriage counselor who happens to be my senior pastor in the person of Reverend Dr. Robert Ayin, the head pastor of House of Hope Assemblies of God. We also have a senior registrar of marriages at the Registrar General Department in the person of Mr. Enoch Kwe. I believe as the program progresses, all these will have the opportunity to make their intervention. We have two of the special guests seated among the congregation this morning. I know they will not want to come forward, but I'll have to introduce them all the same. Both of them are married together, medical doctors of profession, and the man is a pastor as well. Pastor, doctor, and Dr. Mrs. Esuma. Shall we please So those at the high table at the appropriate time will get them introduced. But in the meantime, we have an attendance, a choral ambassadors, and we'll have them give us a rendition from the film. Come on.
Yes, you understand the
speaker this morning has convinced me beyond every doubt that I have to be here to listen to him. Now, I don't know whether he is competent for you, but for me, he's competent. He's a person who started as a science student. He has BSc in agriculture, animal science, and field in animal science, microbiology, and immunology from the University of Ghana, and where he was actively involved in Christian ministry. Then he decided to change. I don't know what happened to him. he began at the Berea International Theological Seminary in Seoul, South Korea, where he obtained his Master of Divinity degree. And he was privileged to study under the pastor of the world's largest Baptist church, Dr. Kidong Kim of the Sandrak Baptist Church, South Korea. He didn't stop there. He went on to do his Doctor of Theology. You know, most men of God, when they write their names, they put Doctor or Reverend Doctor Percy Watson. He doesn't want to put Reverend Doctor Amanor Darkwa or Darkwa Amanor. He puts THD. But for the uninformed people who are not studying theology, they don't understand what we're saying. So, okay, let's move on. This gentleman who's going to speak to us has taught in a number of Bible schools in Ghana, including Berea Academy, International Theological Seminary, Agape Bible College, Victory International Bible Institute, Shalom Victory Bible College, and Bible College of Ghana. So he's a man with a wealth of experience in theological education. He is the main resource person of the Berean Ministers Fellowship. Fellowship that brings together ministers of independent churches for continuous theological education, for fellowship, and for mutual support. Now, what are his teaching emphases? His teaching emphasis is on challenging the church to move away from theology, and also a theologian, rooted in mere intellectualism and human traditions and imaginations, to a theology which is rooted in the Bible, especially not the Old Testament, but the New Testament. This gentleman, this man of God, is the senior pastor of the Crossroads Community Church, Accra, Ghana, and is the director of Berea Academy, Crossroads Community Church branch. Now, I'm going to mention his name again. He's going to speak on marriage. Marriage is being or has been redefined in so many countries. We have homosexual marriage. We have gay and we have lesbian. We have bestiality, men marrying animals. Is that men marrying their daughters? Yes, Bible talks about that. So, what is marriage? What is Christian marriage? What is traditional marriage? This morning we are privileged to have a pastor and a teacher who has been in this business of teaching the Word of God since 1977. Would you help me to receive Reverend Dr. Darkwa Amanor?
Center, University of Ghana, Lagos.
Oh, this is John Gordon Ujiri. Shall we please? Unfortunately, he is the former director of placement. If he is, when we close, I'll ask some of the young people to see him. But he's now the director of Excellent Youth Outreach and the senior pastor of Antioch World Harvest Outreach Ministry, North Legon. Then I earlier introduced Dr. and Dr. Mrs. Achie Suman. I didn't mention Dr. Achie Suman is associate pastor of Holy Ghost Revival Center, Assemblies of God, South Odoko. Then we have Reverend Mrs. Rosa Antine, the senior pastor of Christ is Life Ministry International. And you're welcome. Then we have Reverend and Mrs. Kwame Ofosu Adakwa from Priesthood International Ministries, Amazon. There was somebody I did not introduce earlier when I came, and that person is the resident pastor of Trinity Methodist Society, Medina Estate, and she's the director, Religious Broadcasting, Ghana Broadcasting Corporation, in the person of very Reverend Helen Opoku Sakoni. Shall we put our hands together? Before Dr. Amanor comes with the letter for today, the choral ambassadors will give us a rendition of Efremamu's Asemi Dekan. Choral ambassadors, shall we please put our hands together?
Alumni and associates have done an excellent job of successfully putting together the program for this year's lecture. They deserve a great deal of commendation for their sacrifice in preparatory meetings and giving financially to support the lecture, and in praying much for the success of this year's lecture. God richly reward you all for your sacrifice and love for the Berea movement. I also acknowledge our numerous sponsors who have contributed in cash and in kind to ensure the successful hosting of this year's lecture. Time and space will not allow the listing of all of your names. The Lord who sees in secret will be the one to reward all of you openly. My final appreciation and thanks go to my wife, Efia, who actually is the brain behind the institution of the Berea Lecture Series. The purpose of our gathering this morning is to attempt to resolve an issue which has agitated my mind for some time now. It is about the theologically, culturally, and linguistically irreconcilable phenomenon of double marriage ceremonies, which have characterized African Christian marriages since Africa's encounter with Western European missionaries about 200 years ago. My hope is that by the end of this lecture, the status of Christian couples who go through and complete the customary rites of marriage would have been settled. The crucial question to ask include one. Are African Christians who go through and complete the customary rites of marriage engaged or married? In other words, is the performance of the customary marriage rites an engagement announcement or a wedding? Two. Is a white wedding in church under the marriage ordinance, the Christian wedding? Three, does God bless the marriages of Christian couples who only marry customarily at home? Four, are the Ghanaian customary rites of marriage pagan or biblical? So these are the questions you want to try and respond. These questions have become important and necessary to ask because in many African churches today, a couple is considered properly wedded in Christ and before God only if their marriage has been celebrated and blessed in church. This is usually in a grand European type wedding or in what we in Ghana call a blessing, a relatively low-key marriage ceremony in church. What is common to both, however, is that they are all celebrated in church and totally directed by the church. This is a must and a necessary prerequisite for the church's acceptance of the marriage as having been contracted in Christ and before God. This is regardless of the fact that prior to either of these, an elaborate customary process of investigation, consultation, and marriage rites would have been completed to the satisfaction of the couple and their two families and friends. Nevertheless, the African church insists on having the couple and their families appear in church for another marriage ceremony, which they call a wedding or a blessing. By this insistence, the church in Africa gives the impression that the performance of the customary rites of marriage is an incomplete process of marriage and that the process is completed only in church by a church wedding under the marriage ordinance. By this insistence also, the African church gives the impression that God does not bless marriages contracted anywhere else other than the church setting in the chapel, and by extension, that God dwells only in the chapel. Again, by this insistence, the church in Africa gives the impression that parents and families lack the full authority to give their daughters and their sons in marriage. And unless the church completes the process, marriages contracted only customarily are without the full approval of God and of the full approval and blessing of God. By this insistence of the African church of another marriage ceremony in church, prospective African Christian couples have the double burden of financing two marriage ceremonies whose budgets are usually beyond the means of many an up-and-coming eligible bachelor. Is this demand by the African church of a second marriage ceremony in church after the customary marriage ceremony at home, supported by the Holy Scriptures? Is that what God demands of prospective Christian couples? Was that the understanding of the Lord Jesus and of the early apostles and prophets who served as the chief cornerstone foundation, respectively, of the New Testament church? And was that the practice of the primitive New Testament church? Evangelical churches are noted for being unrepentant biblicists. That means evangelical churches consider the Bible and the Bible alone as the authoritative source of faith and practice. Martin Luther once said, "When the Bible speaks, God has spoken." Martin Luther suggested by this that God speaks to his church only through the Bible. And whatever the church does, allows, and institutes must have foundation in the Bible and in the Bible alone. Extra-biblical influences rooted in man-made traditions, no matter how popular or how ancient and nice, should therefore not form a basis for any practice in an evangelical church. Weddings in the early New Testament church. Marriage is presented as a sacred institution by the Bible. The New Testament, for instance, has many divine injunctions regarding the practice of marriage for the guidance of Christian couples. These are found in Jesus' answers to the persons the Pharisees asked to test him regarding the legality or otherwise of no false divorce in Matthew chapter 19, verse 1 to 12. The rest of the New Testament teaching for Christian couples were given by the Apostle Peter in his letter to the Jewish Christians in the diaspora in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1 to 7, and by Paul in his letter to the churches in Corinth, Ephesus, and Colossae in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, Ephesians chapter 5, 22 to 28, and Colossians chapter 3, 18 to 19. Incidentally, there is not even one incident of a religious wedding in the whole New Testament. There are no examples of a New Testament wedding celebrated in the temple or in a synagogue or in a house church. It appears that the early New Testament church and the leaders were not in favor of projecting weddings as religious ceremonies and therefore did not make any church revelations regarding the religious celebration of marriages. Marriage ceremonies were considered by the early New Testament church as civil or customary ceremonies which were left to the families of the two parties involved in the marriage covenant and or the civil authority. This understanding of the early New Testament church is what informed the actions of the Puritans of the 1900s Great Britain, who also married in civil ceremonies because they claim not to have found any example of a wedding ceremony which was a religious service in the Bible. There is only one actual wedding story in the New Testament. This wedding took place at Cana of Galilee. And the Lord Jesus Christ, his mother and his brothers and his disciples were in attendance and participated in the ceremony. It did not take place in the temple, since the temple was located in Jerusalem, and there were no officiating priests and scribes. Jesus Christ and his disciples were present, but the Bible did not present them as officiating ministers for the ceremony. If the wine had not run out, perhaps the presence of Jesus and his disciples at the ceremony would have been missed in the account. The ceremony was a customary marriage celebration conducted according to the Hebrew custom, with family and guests in attendance. Even Jesus Christ must have been there as a family member, because his mother and his brothers were also present. Jesus did not usually go on his itinerant mission with his mother and his brothers, since his brothers did not believe in him. John chapter 7 verse 5. And his family sometimes thought he was insane, going about preaching. So they would not follow him. So if then all of them were there, then it means the person was a family member. At this wedding, his mother appeared to be in charge of the catering services, further pointing to the fact that Jesus must have been family to either the bride or the groom. Nevertheless, even though what took place that day at Cana was a customary marriage celebration in the house of perhaps a family member described as the master of the feast, that is John chapter 2 verse 9, the Bible describes what took place as the wedding at Cana. It would be interesting to find out how an African Christian would have described what took place at Cana that day. He would more likely have described it as the engagement at Cana. The reason is that to an African Christian, a marriage ceremony that takes place customarily in the house, away from the church, without all the European trappings, is an engagement, but not a wedding. How did marriage ceremonies end up as religious services conducted in church? The church, from its inception in the first century, did not devise any special wedding ceremonies to celebrate the marriages of its members. Marriage ceremonies were thought of as primarily a private matter, with no uniform religious or other ceremony being required. That is why no such guidelines for weddings exist in the New Testament. The vows we make are not in the New Testament. Somebody sat somewhere and concocted them and forced it upon all of us. The duty of the church in the marriage of her members are seen as a teaching of husbands and wives before and after their wedding to live godly married lives. Weddings did not become religious or official church activities until the Roman Catholic Church declared matrimony to be one of her seven sacraments. Besides the sacrament of matrimony, the Roman Catholic Church has six other sacraments, namely the Eucharist, that is the Holy Communion, baptism, holy order, that is ordination, confirmation, extreme unction, that is anointing the sick with oil, and penance. Both the Roman Catholic and the Protestant device of Christianity consider marriage to have been divinely instituted by God from the beginning of mankind's history. However, while the Roman Catholic Church considers marriage to be a sacrament, the Protestant Church rejects the theology of the sacrament of matrimony. Even in the Roman Catholic Church, marriage did not become a sacrament requiring solemnization in church until the Middle Ages, around the 9th century. Sacraments are taught by the Roman Catholic Church to be the means by which grace is communicated and are crucial for salvation. And the sacrament of matrimony, therefore, is a means by which grace is communicated to the couple and is crucial for the couple's salvation. The marriage must therefore be celebrated between two baptized Roman Catholics during Holy Mass because of the connection of all the sacraments to the Paschal mystery of Christ, that is the Holy Communion. And it must be preceded with the sacrament of penance. By this, the couple is believed to have sealed their consent to give themselves to each other through the offering of their own lives by uniting it with the offering of Christ for his church made present in the Eucharistic sacrifice. Thus, receiving the Eucharist at the marriage ceremony, in church also communicates in the same body and the same blood of Christ their formation of one body in Christ. Roman Catholics believe that, as a sacrament, matrimony is required to be celebrated between baptized Roman Catholics in church, in the presence of a priest, who usually imposes his liturgical stole upon the couple's hands as a sign to confirm the marriage bond. Wedding rings are required to be worn after the vows have been said to seal the marriage sacrament. The use of the wedding ring did not even come into use in Roman Catholic marriage ceremony until the 9th century AD, over 800 years after the establishment of the church. The custom of wearing the wedding ring on the fourth finger of the left hand of the bride is based on an unscientific Egyptian and Greek fable that the artery from that finger flows directly to the heart. It is not scientifically proven. Wearing a wedding ring as a seal of the sacrament of matrimony is not a requirement for married Christians as far as the Bible is concerned. Many see it today as a symbol of an unending commitment to the marriage relationship. Symbols really have no place in the New Testament because of the risk of idolization. The New Testament deals with realities ensured and guaranteed by the indwelling Holy Spirit. Arguably, the insistence on church weddings by the Roman Catholic Church cannot be faulted because of her theology of the sacrament of matrimony, which requires marriages to be celebrated in church in the presence of a priest and in combination with other sacraments such as the Eucharist. The difficulty is in the insistence by Protestant churches on church weddings when Protestantism rejects the Roman Catholic theology of the sacrament of matrimony. Protestant theology rejects the existence of seven sacraments, including the sacrament of matrimony. Protestantism accepts only two ordinances, namely baptism and the Holy Communion, which, as far as it is concerned, were specifically commanded to be observed in the church by the Lord Jesus himself, and does not accept matrimony or any of the remaining four Roman Catholic sacraments as biblical. The spirit of Protestantism, therefore, supports the fact that the celebration of marriage should be a civil, social, or a customary activity, but not a religious or church ceremony. Many Christians are ignorant of the Roman Catholic theology of the sacrament of matrimony, which from the 9th century onwards transformed the customary or civil marriage ceremony into a religious wedding and moved it from the house to the church. As a result of their ignorance, they suppose that the church wedding is the right ceremony for Christians and has been so from the beginning of the church and has the endorsement of Jesus. The presence of Jesus and his disciples at the customary non-religious wedding at Cana and the early church's attitude of not seeing the importance of a church wedding, and therefore not making any regulations regarding weddings by Christians in church, are ample evidence that customary wedding, but not church wedding, is God's ideal for Christian marriages. The church wedding is a purely European culture that has been Christianized for acceptance to Europeans. After the dissolution of the Roman Empire, the idea arose of Europe as one large church state called Christendom. This was the time when supreme authority in Europe was vested in the Pope, who exercised it even over the secular authority of kings and emperors. It was at this stage in European history that Christianity and European culture merged, making the purely European white wedding a so-called Christian wedding. Influences from Africa's contact with Western Europe. Despite its positive contribution of formal education, linguistic studies, trade and commerce, a healthcare system, architecture, roads and transport, and above all, the introduction of Christianity, Africa's encounter with Western Europe also had a downside. This included the infamous transatlantic slave trade, which made Africa poorer by the plundering of both human and natural resources from the continent, the scramble for Africa's rich and fertile lands, and worst of all, the degrading of Africa's culture and the resultant superimposition of Africa's culture with Europe's culture. A case in point is the dismissal of Mr. Ephraim Amu from the Presbyterian Training College at Propong Agrapim by the management of the college in 1931. His crime was that of sacrilege, in that he taught what in the words of the missionary principal, and I quote, the horrible cacophony of music they call African music, and caused to be beating pagan African drums in God's college. Worst of it all, he once dressed again in the words of the missionary principal, like an uncivilized pagan African and an idol worshipper of the worst kind, to preach in God's pulpit. And all that Mr. Ephraim Amu did to deserve these insults and unfair treatment was that, as a music tutor of the college, he introduced Christian music in a papyri, accompanied by African percussion instruments, to the college. Moreover, on one Sunday, when it was his turn to preach to the college, he mounted the pulpit attired in an African cloth, on jumper and buggy shorts, matching with an ahinema. This was sacrilege, according to the European missionaries and the Europeanized African clergy, and a crime punishable by a dismissal from the college. This conception of Western missionaries of African culture was the result of the effect of European supremacist anthropology on Western Christian thought, Europe's inability to understand the cultures of the rest of the world, and the need to justify the trade in human slaves resulted in a superiority complex in Europe that saw the people in the rest of the world as inferior beings who were incapable of a higher form of religion. Beginning with Plato and Aristotle in the Middle Ages, an idea of a hierarchy of being was deeply embedded in European culture. This was crystallized by the 18th century into what was referred to as the Great Chain of Being. The import of this philosophical idea was that there was a divinely ordained position in creation for the different races of the world, and harmony is achieved only when each people group occupied its providentially determined position in the hierarchy. This idea, which became a fundamental part of the intellectual outlook in Europe in the 18th century, ensured that the Negro, or the black race, was at the bottom of the ranking following white, red, and yellow races. So Europeans thought that God had divinely arranged the races in a ladder. And the white is at the top. The red is at the next. The yellow, the next. And the Negro is at the last. And since the Negro is at the last, his intelligence is just like that of the pig. And therefore, he is not capable of conceiving the higher God. So the God he claims he knows is not the God in heaven. He's the God in between heaven and the earth. This theory was popularized in the 19th century by British anthropologists and comparative religions. One was called John Lubbock, the other was E.B. Tyler, the other one was J.G. Fraser. They based it on Darwinian evolutionary assumptions of development from lower, simpler forms to higher, more refined and complex levels of culture. Since the theory associated stages of material culture with corresponding stages in mental and spiritual culture, lower material accomplishments of primitive peoples pointed naturally to equally backward levels of moral, religious, and intellectual development. Consequently, the culture and religion of so-called primitive and uncivilized Africans were branded by the European missionaries as fetishism or animism, and considered backward and incapable of conceiving the higher God. As a result of this perception of Africa, the European missionary approach tended to treat everything pre-Christian in Africa as either harmful or at best valueless, and considered the African once converted from paganism as a candidate for a wholly new religious psychology. Evangelization was thus reduced to the de-Africanization of Africans into Christian converts, with a whole new approach to thinking and behavior, which was nothing more than merely adopting a Eurocentric mindset. So when they say they are coming to convert us to become Christians, all they succeeded in doing is to convert us to become Europeans in the way we think and dress. So if you became a Christian, they insisted that you should take the Christian name, which was nothing more than Francis or Robert or Jones. And without it, you can never be a Christian. Pamnandapa is pagan because it comes from Africa. And therefore, if you want to become a Christian, Pamnandapa is not sufficient description of a Christian. So you must add Jones to it. So Jones Pamnandapa is now a Christian, converted from Pamnandapa to Jones Pamnandapa. The question is, what is Christian about Jones? Or wood? Or rice? What is Christian about rice? But in when we were in school, if you were just for Pamnandapa, you were in trouble. You were a bushman. If you were called Francis, you are civilized. This is all European thinking. It is in the light of this European colonization and denigration of African culture that the African customary marriage and its rights came to be devalued and reduced into an incomplete pagan and unchristian marriage process called an engagement that must require a European-type church wedding to purify and complete it for acceptance by the African church. It is shameful that this mindset of superimposing European culture on African culture for its supposed inferiority, which the white missionaries succeeded in implanting in African minds, still persists in Africa over 50 years after she gained her independence from European political, economic, and cultural control. Furthermore, the Bible has no such tradition. And even Jesus Christ considered the customary marriage and its rights as divine and complete. He did not see the need to recommend the following of the customary marriage ceremony at Canaan with the religious marriage service in the temple in Jerusalem before the